If you would stand now for the entrance procession. The didgeridoo player here is Father John Bosman at MSC. He'll be playing from the front of the church, and then the cross bearer and the celebrants and celebrants will come in immediately with the didgeridoo playing.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We'll begin our prayer today in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And I invite Elder Elsie, to come forward for acknowledgement to come.
Good morning, everyone. It's important that we acknowledge the first people of this country, and that is the reason why I'm here today. For thousands of years, my people have walked on this land. The footprints of my ancestors are imprinted on the earth. As a Wiradjuri elder, I acknowledge with respect the traditional ancestors of this land, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation. I reflect on the caring and spiritual connection to Mother Earth and all of God's creatures. We live in hope, peace and harmony to improve the quality of life in all our people. We thank our elders, past and present, whose wisdom guides us through crises of identity, so we can hold on to our past, live in the present, while building a better future for our children and our children's children. Together we walk the road to reconciliation in peace and unity. Mungawa by Ami, great creative spirit of Aboriginal people. Peace be with you.
Thank you, Elsie. A great welcome to you all here today, and undoubtedly you will all come here today with many different memories of Frank. Frank's a unique human being, quite unique, with special gifts and talents and strengths, and also great frailties and vulnerabilities. And we acknowledge him in his entirety today, in his humanity. And at the beginning of the ceremony today, we also light the paschal candle. And every time I light the paschal candle, I'm reminded of that Lem Cohen song, that everything is cracked and broken because that's how the light gets in. And it reminds us of the light and the power of Christ in our own life as we light this today. We now have a special ritual of water blessing of the congregation and also the coffin, and I'd ask John and Anne to come forward with the water for blessing. Seated for this part of the ritual.
all of you who really know that he had many facets to his character. The first song that we're going to place reflects his priesthood, and that will be put on by Father Edelman, and it consists of the chalice, the stole, and his breviary. One of these stoles was very important, Father's just got it now, to Frank, because it was presented to him by a Lithuanian priest, and it apparently is done in the most, well, it is done in the most amazing cross-section. He wore it on all important occasions and loved it very much. And the second one, and those again of you who, what you remember Frank, he always wore his beret, summer or winter. That was a trademark. And his sister Lord Anne is going to put that and a scarf, because inevitably the scarf went with the beret as well. The next symbol is very important as well, and that is the Aboriginal paintings and clap sticks. And also a very beautiful vestment that was actually given to him by the Aboriginal Catholic ministry. So very important. And this special vestment. Running out of room here. Central to all priests in the MSCs is the concept of the spirituality of the heart. And it was a very important motivating fact for Frank and inspired his religious life and is reflected in many of his writings and in his books. And the next symbol that we're going to place is that book, the book that we finally, or he finally, wrote. And it's to be presented here by the editor who helped him and supported him and consulted him. It's Jesus and the Dreaming. Thank you. As well as his pastoral work, Frank also was an academic and he studied for his doctorate in theology. And my brother Gerald is going to place the hat that he wore on his graduation day. And there are two very special people here, the Frank, and that's Svetlana Mann, who was his acupuncturist for 17 years, and more recently, Yang. And both of them visited him in the hospital the last 10 days when he was very ill. Yang giving him a massage, and Svetlana there for support. But over the years, he has had them working with him, and they really did miraculous things, keeping him going. So call on Svetlana and Yang to come and place acupuncture and also massage books that they have on this casket. Frank found solace in literature, in art, in music, that he was a great moviegoer. And it goes back to his childhood when Saturday afternoon he was going to the flicks of the Brits. He loved them, and it was a lifelong thing for him to keep in touch with the present world, I think, through a lot of the films that he saw. So I'm asking our niece, Claire, to place the movie tickets, many movie tickets.
Thank you, Terry, and let us pray. Hear with favour our prayers which we humbly offer, O Lord, for the salvation of the soul of Frank, your servant in Greece, that he who devoted a faithful ministry to your name may rejoice in the perpetual company of your saints, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. So we have two eulogies now, and Elsie, and followed by Brendan, is Frank's nephew. Thank you.
Tribute to Father Frank Fletcher. A priest, a friend, a humble humanitarian, a fighter for justice, a gentle man of action, strong in spirituality and faith. I'd like to share a short reading that reminds me of Father Frank. A reading from James. Second chapter, verse 18. But someone will say, one person has faith, another has actions. My answer is, show me how anyone can have faith without actions. I will show you my faith by my actions. This was Frank Fletcher. He was always thinking of others. By serving the community, his faith was demonstrated through his actions. And because I shared his beliefs and most of the people in the ACM, our journey included with him and the interaction in the Aboriginal Catholic ministry. And this all began at Erskineville. After Frank Fletcher retired, I moved to La Perouse to set up the Reconciliation Church, which was a dream both he and I shared. As an Aboriginal church, and having it in the Sydney Archdiocese, a place of our own, just for Aboriginal people to feel comfortable. There's so many stories there why we didn't attend church at that time. A place to continue the work that was started in Erskineville and which was established. And La Perouse is a big challenge with a small budget. Father Frank led the first community meeting with the late Mum Cheryl, Bishop John Heaps, Aidan Ridgway, Dr. Valerie, Brian Carroll, and myself. in August of 89. In November 1998, the journey in La Perouse finally began, and Frank said our first Mass and performed five baptisms. The work at Erskineville and at La Perouse continues today with Val and Kate and Graham Mundine. In the following years, many more community members joined the ACM, including Christine Mitchell, Kay Hookey, Frank Kane, Barbara Aspert, Brenda McDonald, and Graham Mundine. When the ACM was beginning to grow, Frank never wanted to be a leader. I said to him, "You lead and we will follow." He said, "No, you lead and I will follow. I will never walk in front of Aboriginal people. I will walk with you or behind you." That was one of his great assets that he had. I talked about many things to Frank Fletcher. One was regarding the fact that I was used to do a lot of driving at night, and I was always worried that I would never get back to my family. I said I needed a prayer to make me feel safe. He said, "This prayer, Elsie, you say this prayer every time you get in your car. Dear Sacred Heart of Jesus, I place my trust in thee. I am never without this prayer." How can you tell one story about our shared journey in a few minutes? There are many stories, like travelling by train to Aboriginal Islander Council meetings, travelling all over New South Wales, taking our swags with us, and Barry would remember that. There was always lots of joy and laughter most of the time. A big group from the ACM would hop on that train and we would sing, and it was joyous that we were all together. Frank organised trips to the assembly of NACSIC. One year, Sister Pat Ormisher from the Gathering House on the Block and I went to Darwin. It was 1994. And then the beatification of Mary McKillop, our Blessed Mary McKillop. Father Frank organised 35 Aboriginal people to be in the smoking ceremony on that day, as well as taking First Communion and other things. How many men could have done what he'd done? I just don't know. I know that we relied on him so much. And I know that his shoulders carried a load. There's much more. I would need a few hours to tell this eulogy. Father Frank was also a friend of many families. My children grew up with the Aboriginal Catholic ministry in their lives. My dear husband Joseph was a great friend of Father Frank, and he always came and made sure he had a cup of tea at our house. Frank enjoyed a good laugh. He enjoyed the stories we would tell him. He went from land rights marches to Archie Roach concerts. The first survivor concert at La Perouse in 1991. And he said to me, "Wasn't that a good song, Trudy?" I said, "Yes." He said, "I was humming along with that, Elsie." He went to all community functions and speaking engagements, whether it was about spirituality or just celebrating NAIDOC Week. Justice for everyone was so important to him. Wherever Aboriginal people were involved, he was there. So many people today would have their own stories of Father Frank Fletcher. This is just a small tribute to a man who walked with us and loved us. For who we were, not judging or condemning, but sharing our dreaming. To you, Father Frank Fletcher, we say to you, we will see you in the dream time. Go gently with the sacred heart of Jesus. From all the Aboriginal people whose lives you have touched, we say, Creator, Fiamme Spirit, look after our brother.
Thanks, Auntie Elsie. I was born in 1973, sometime after Uncle Frank. Given my youth compared to Frank's wisdom, I have in truth struggled with how to put words to his life this week. How to do justice to a man who touched so many and lived such a multidimensional life. But at some point I realised these feelings of uncertainty and vulnerability were feelings that Frank would recognise himself. So I'm simply going to tell a few stories from his life. And as Elsie said, they're but fragments of a whole. And we can all contribute to the man Frank was. My brother, who's overseas at the moment, Luke, proud to say he's studying in Cambridge political science, just to let you know that Frank wasn't the only academic in the family, has written some beautiful words about Frank. He says quite simply, First, for Brendan, Claire and I, Frank was just a presence, a soft, radiant energy that glowed in our young lives, the personification of kindness and love. That's exactly how I remember Frank for many years. We spent most Sundays at our granny and grandfather's place on Milford Street, just there. And we celebrated those days like ritual. Aunt Terry, Uncle Frank, my father Gerald, my mother Anne, a Sunday roast, and they've been on this movie. But it starts before then for Frank in the same postcode. New Year's Day, 1932. Frank was the firstborn of his generation on both sides of his family, born to Jack and Ogie. Jack, my grandfather, charming, strong, cantankerous, unforgettable. My grandmother, Ogie, his mother, one of God's little people, as Frank called her. Ogie's mother, Rose, lived with the family when they were growing up. And both Rose and Ogie doted on Frank since he was a child. When Frank was four, Johnny was born, another beautiful looking son. He was certainly the apple of his mum's eye, followed 4 years later by Therese Mary, known to us all today as Terry. Johnny must have had some winning ways because he refused to go to school and my grandfather let him. He simply came home and hid under the bed. Jack would come home and say, oh, well, that's okay. I still find that hard to believe, but my father's not here. For the rest of the year, Johnny didn't have to go to school. Although it was the depression years, it was a time talked about with great fondness. And from those early years, the qualities of equality and social justice were instilled in the children growing up. Frank told me a story only a year ago of being home alone as a boy. A man came to the door seeking work or perhaps some leftover food or tea. Frank was uncertain how to respond to such a request, especially being the only one at home. So you might imagine his father's shock when Jack came home from work to find a homeless man in his kitchen, drinking tea with Frank, the boy. When Frank told me this story, it was clear he feared a reprimand from grandfather. But Jack came up to Frank, put his hand on his shoulder and simply said, "You did the right things." Sadly, at just 6 years of age, Johnny took ill with a stomach problem, was admitted to hospital, and died shortly after. Frank was 10 at the time. His memories of that day stuck with him his whole life. He describes how he woke up to an incredible stillness in the house. His father came into the room and told him what happened, suggesting maybe Frank be strong for his mother. But as soon as he saw Rachel, he flew into her arms and they held each other tight. The tragedy rippled through the family, but OG was devastated. She took to her bed for over a year after Johnny's death and struggled to shake the depression. For Frank to experience the death of a loved one, a younger brother at such a young age, no doubt had a profound effect on his life. Many people speak of Frank's ability to feel their pain, to understand their struggle. One can only imagine the darkness he bore witness to, and perhaps enable the compassion that we knew Frank to have so well. Frank has told me he remembers clearly his mother praying with him every night. And he said to me, "I couldn't make head or tail of it. Holy pictures, my mother taking it all very seriously. She never spent too long there, she was very shrewd. But I was always thinking, where is this Jesus?" When Frank was walking back from church, 11, perhaps 12 years old, he had an experience that would change his life forever. He was literally knocked off his feet by a force he could not see. You can read about this in various parts of his writing. He describes it quite simply as a religious experience. In Frank's own words, "I had an extraordinary experience of love coming home from church that day. I began to dance around, and all I could say is, it is true." Can you imagine the shocked faces when Frank announced he wanted to begin studies for the priesthood at 14 years of age? Auntie Terry has told me that his mother and grandmother, those two most pious of women, met with the priest with stony faces as he told them his intentions, and they began to contemplate perhaps losing in their eyes another son. It is a testament to both the power of Frank's faith and the love of his parents that in 1948 Frank was on that train to Douglas Park to begin studies preparing for priesthood. He was 16 years of age. The bonds that Frank formed with his fellow students in those early years are strong. We were privileged last night to hear memories shared at the monastery by some students who were by his side in that year, and I'm no doubt here today. Frank was ordained a priest in 1956 in St. Mary's Cathedral. His first placement was a teacher at Chevalier School in Barrow in 1957. By his own admission, this assignment was not a great success. I shudder to imagine a 10 to 25-year-old Frank in front of a classroom full of rowdy boys. Some of those boys I see here today. However, he had an impact on those young men. His former students speak of their deep fondness of him. Many remain touched, even until this year. Tony Bain spoke last night, recollecting these times, and even acknowledging that former New South Wales Premier John Fay, a student of Frank's, had been in touch with Tony this week, conveying that those early teachings instilled in him a wonderful sense of humanity and justice. And Frank was just getting started. The good news for our family was that we had a priest at our disposal. Frank's first wedding was his cousin Barbara Wood to Ross Wood. However, legend has it, not all of the family were completely confident in Frank's ability. Maybe he was not going to get it right. After all, this was his first time. What if he made a mistake and Barbara and Ross were unlawfully wed? To prevent disaster, the family invited Monsignor Tom Wallace to the wedding, just to keep an eye on things and make sure that Frank goes lines right. Frank's first baptism with sisters Victoria and Trini Wood, who I see here today and will be carrying up the offertory. What followed in the 60s was a number of passionate years within the MSC community, where Frank had a particular dedication as vocations director. I can imagine Frank being a welcoming and kind extended set of arms for those considering the same choices as he did. He had a particular focus on late vocations, and through his hard work and vision, this led to the establishment of St Paul's Seminary for Late Vocations in 1968. This is something not to be underestimated. I wonder how many people Frank personally guided through these transitions into the seminary, how many special relationships were formed, and I wonder about the ripple of Frank's love through the community because of that. And Frank always kept a connection with his family. He would take his mother over to the movies whenever he could, Randwick Brits. One of those movies in 1968 was called Every Bastard a King, one of Frank's favourite stories. He was sitting in the Ritz quiet theatre with his mother, getting elderly by now, she was. The movie began. OT became a bit restless. Wasn't too keen on where this film was going. She turned to Frank. What's this film called again? What? What was that? Every Bastard a King. Frank whispered, desperately trying not to say the words too loud. Speak up, I can't hear you. Every Bastard a King. Frank found himself proclaiming, only to find his mother mortified. I'm not sure where they stayed before filming. This is one of Frank's favourite stories. He told that story over and over again. Embedded in this story is his tremendous love for his mother and her implicit trust in him. Frank loved stories as we all knew, and he was a master storyteller. He had perfected the long dramatic pause, I mean the really long dramatic pause, the moment of revelation, and the all-important art of comic timing. He also understood the deeper stories of people's lives. He knew it before they spoke. Frank went on to become a superior at the seminary in Canberra, and then later on in Florida. And all this time, he was writing his theology. Firstly, his master's in 1972, finally his doctorate in 1983. He spent many years abroad. He had unforgettable years in the Bronx in New York. Again, I just enjoy imagining the idea of Uncle Frank in 1969 in the Bronx. It's clear that his horizons expanded dramatically at that time. his stories about Toronto, where he did his doctorate, studied, you know, for many, a couple of years there. His stories clearly told us what a profound experience that was to be able to talk with others about his beloved Lonergan. I think he even interacted with Lonergan. His intellectual inspiration was a pivotal moment. And he also formed lifelong bonds with people in America and Canada. To this day, I mean, they were ringing up little sisters this week. And those friendships provided a source of ongoing joy for Frank all through his life. Frank did not just talk about social justice. He did not just write about it. He lived it. He did it. This was, of course, most powerfully expressed through his relationship with the Aboriginal community. Frank saw the profound richness and wisdom of Aboriginal culture. He saw that Aboriginal culture not only could enrich us all, but that it must enrich us all if we are to create something genuinely unique and lasting about being Australian. We watched his passion grow as his relationship with his challenging ministry deepened through the 80s and the 90s. We've heard Elsie speak already and we'll hear others speak again today. To all the Aboriginal people here today, I want to say thank you. And I want to say that Frank loved you. He loved you with all his heart and was deeply touched by his time alongside you. Frank was a man of action. He did the hard yards on the streets, in the houses, at funerals and in hospitals. It was a challenging time. It was a time of heartbreak and loneliness at times, I know that. But there were tremendous fun times as well. Barbara told me once the story of when he came to bless her house. On the way through the blessing, stumbled upon her nephew on the couch, looking maybe slightly worse for wear. Frank said, "I'll give him a double dose, Barbara." This week, tributes have poured in from Aboriginal people near and far. We've been graced with emails and phone calls from Aidan Ridgway, who today is in Broken Hill, from Patrick Dodson in Broome, and Tiger Bales in Brisbane. Some, like Brenda, have flown from interstate to be with us today, and that means very much to us. And I know to Frank. When Frank's Koori friends have told us over the years what he's meant to them, it's not possible to feel more proud of him, a brother or a friend. The great legacy of all this, all of Frank's journey is, of course, the book, Jesus and the Dreamer. Many people will recall conversations about the book from 10 years ago, I dare say from 20 years ago. It has been a long and layered gestation. I've had the privilege of seeing glimpses of this over the last few years coming together. Like perhaps some of you, I've been into his office and seen the overflowing folders, the paintings, the homilies, the newspaper articles, the letters, the Christmas cards. I don't even think Frank understood the filing system. But what this spoke of was a rich and vibrant inner life. He nurtured his inner life. He was on a constant journey, a constant search. And when I mean say constant, I mean till last week he was on constant search. And yet his external life was grand. It was boundless. His capacity was astounding. Frank struggled with this book for many years. Some of us doubted whether there would actually be a book. I think Frank was top of that list. No one was closer than Fabian, who studied under Frank and ultimately facilitated the completion of the book and the vast amount of writings were edited together in partnership with Fabian. Frank mentored so many of us. He had the ability to take us to the edge and sit there with us and be unafraid with us. He taught us that in these moments, Jesus came, and in these moments, the healing happened. The book is to be published, we believe, early next year. Phrases like the holy fire and sacral imagination rise off the page in Frank's hand. He was gentle, we all talk about this, but let us not forget that Frank was radical. He would come at things from a surprising, unexpected directions, and that was part of his brilliance. I think his brilliance was perhaps only matched by his humility, a rare combination. Something perhaps not so many people know is his gift for poetry. There are some booklets here today which carry some of his poems from the last 10 years. Frank was not a man without fault. His most obvious fault, his most glaring fault, was his fashion sense. No amount of Hail Marys could atone for that. He quite simply should never have been allowed to leave the house without his sister's wardrobe. Father leaves an enormous legacy. He was an esteemed MSC priest, a doctor of theology. The Aboriginal Catholic ministry is strong and flourishing. His words will remain with us for countless years. And his book remains, still yet to be let loose on the world. And yet what we will overwhelmingly remember is Frank's way with people. His wonderful capacity to touch people and act with compassion. To quote Frank himself, the human journey in all its brutalities, complexities and structures pivots ultimately on love. Frank, you are well loved. It's hard to reconcile how you could be so clever yet so kind, so gentle yet have so much power. So quiet, yet have so much to say. Be so wise, and somehow so forgetful. It has brought us so much joy to watch your holy fire burn so bright for so long and touch so many. We love you, Frank. May God bless you.
Thank you, Elsa. Thanks, Brendan. We now have a number of scripture readings, and the first one will be read by Tricia, a very special friend of Frank's, followed by Mark and Frank's cousin Shane.
A reading from the book of Ezekiel. I will take you from every nation and country and bring you back to your own land. I will sprinkle clean water on you and make you clean from all your idols and everything else that has defiled you. I will give you a new heart and a new mind. I will take away your stubborn heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. Then you will live in the land I gave your ancestors, and you will be my people, and I will be your God. This is the word of the Lord.
Response is, O God, you are my all. You, Lord, are all I have, and you give me all my being. My future is in your hands. How wonderful are your gifts to me, how good they are. I praise the Lord because he guides me, and in the night my conscience warns me. I'm always aware of the Lord's presence. He is near and nothing show me the path that leads to life. Your presence fills me with joy and brings me pleasure forever.
A reading from St. Paul to the Colossians. You are the people. You are the people of God. He loved you, and he chose you for his own. So then, you must clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Be tolerant of one another, and forgive one another. Whenever any of you has a complaint against someone else, you must forgive one another, just as the Lord has forgiven you. And to all those qualities, add love, which binds all things together in perfect unity. The peace that Christ gives you is to guide you in the decisions you make. For it is to this peace that God has called you together in one body. And be thankful. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Yes, Father, this is how you wanted it to happen. My Father has given me all things. No one knows the Son except the Father. No one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are tired from carrying heavy loads, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke and put it on you, and learn from me, because I am gentle and humble in spirit, and you will find rest. For the yoke I will give you is easy, and the load I will put on you is light. And this is the gospel of the Lord. So this is what God is like. So this is who you are. Perhaps Frank saying that in his death. And as we heard in the gospel, God replies, Jesus replies, come to me. You have labored and shouldered my yoke. Come and find rest. So when Frank died and came into God's presence, these must have been some of his thoughts. Well, Frank had taught theology with a doctorate to prove it, and drawing on the thought of Bernard Lonergan to boot, and an academic bonnet there on his coffin. Frank had studied, taught theology of revelation, and now, here in his death, he was present to God, God present to him. Even though Frank had theological insights and could communicate these very well, it was still looking through a glass darkly. But now he was face to face with God, experiencing God's graciousness, and as St. Paul reminds us, knowing and loving as fully as he was known and loved. We've shared in a tribute to him and memories of his ministry with the Aboriginal community. We've shared memories and tribute from the family. Now this is from a perspective of the missionaries of the Sacred Heart. The Fletcher family was from Randwick, from Milford Street, and I must say it never occurred to me to put in anything about the Ritz, the movies, and the symbol there, even on his coffin. But Frank has amazed us by living almost to the age of 82, often frail. He must have been very strong, tenacious of life, even during his final week. He had lived for over 63 years as a missionary of the Sacred Heart, 57 years as a priest. He had spent almost a decade after his ordination in 1956 teaching boys at Shirabe, but that was only the beginning of his ministry. For some people have the gift and the grace of reading the signs of the times. One of the names for this kind of person is prophet. Frank was a kind of prophet in the province. Prophets are not always recognised and acknowledged, and sometimes not honoured in their own country. And that too happened to Frank. While he moved into areas that were not foreseen, areas I'd like to mention in a moment, Frank did not look like a prophet. Students were prone to mimic some of his rather self-deprecating, breastfeeding and scratching gestures with a weary hand raised to the brow. And when it came to such practical things as boiling water or moving from second gear to third gear while driving, Frank was neither prophetic nor practical. So perhaps we're amazed at hearing all these stories about his organisation. Somebody reminded me that he never seemed to be sure whether it was hot or cold. With his beret, here present, and putting on and taking off his blue parka. There's the story of a robbery at Croydon. Frank was never a master of room orderliness, and one of the police investigating, not knowing that nothing was stolen from Frank's room, went in and observed that the thieves really had done over that room. And yet, orderly or not, he achieved a great deal. By the middle of the 1960s, we were on the threshold of a different church, something that he recognised. Let me mention some of the ways in which he responded. While it's still at Chevalier, he produced and edited the first issues of Encounter, an in-house magazine for what was about to emerge, a development of devotion to the Sacred Heart into heart spirituality. He wrote in the first issue that this was to be an open forum of problems for thought, writing, and constructive discussion arising from work in missions, schools, parishes, spreading devotion to the Sacred Heart, preaching. That was in 1964. In a change in society and culture, we heard, he became the first full-time vocations director of the province, just as the Apostolic School at Douglas Park was in its final year. And with the seeming discovery of late vocations, he set up a centre at Kensington, which, with the interest of many Australian bishops, developed into St. Paul's National Seminary and a life of 30 years. Frank was a key part of that exhilarating time in the Australian Church, and then went off to the United States and a theology of revelation. In recent years, Frank was nominated for a life membership of the Australian Catholic Theological Association. I'd like to mention the 1970s. Very difficult times for the work of formation for the province. Frank worked in formation for almost all of the 1970s in Canberra and in Croydon. He was novice master in 1981. Difficult times. I know, I was there, and this is the time to say that I learnt a great deal from Frank in sharing this work at Croydon, and he's seeing into things more clearly than I could. I appreciated his confidence in me and his trust. Not easy times, trying and testing new ways of direction, moments of insight and guidance for students, moments of mistakes, which he and I and the other formation personnel sincerely regret and wish we could change. But there's also a lot of good, a lot of grace. And as we've heard, there's great grace in the next phase of Frank's life and ministry. In the mid-80s, Frank's going to Erskineville, his discovery of the Aboriginal community there. It was a discovery of sympathy, and with the people that became empathy, and the establishment, as we have heard, of the Aboriginal Catholic ministry. It moved Frank's heart. It stimulated his mind and his thinking on spirituality and theology, which we can share when reading the fourth memory book, Jesus and the Dream. But he was there, sharing courses, sharing lives, both pain and joy. And there is the testimony here this morning as the members of the community share their grief in celebrating Frank's life. Earlier this year, Frank was honoured by the community at a special ceremony at La Perouse. Frank was a man of the heart, a man of heart spirituality. He edited a book some years ago called Falling in Love with God. Our readings have reminded us of the core of that spirituality, the passage from the prophet Ezekiel, where the loving and faithful covenant God reaches out to people, washing them clean, giving them a new heart of flesh, putting a new spirit in them. With the result, as St. Paul said, the fruits will be compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness and patience. And to keep all these together and complete them, love. Frank saying, so this is what God is like. So this is who you are. Come and I will give you rest, says God. Frank is now in a communion of saints, in the company of the Jesus who is nearest to the Father's heart and has made him known.
We now have a number of prayers of the faithful, so I'd ask those people who are leading us in those prayers of the faithful to come forward. Andrew, Claire, Fabian, Terry, Anne, Brenda, and Gerald, and Mike. Thanks for Frank's life work as a theologian, and we pray for all theologians, students of theology, all those who were taught by Frank, and all women and men who strive to express their experience of the tremendous mystery of God in words for their own time and place. We pray and hope that Frank's breakthrough insight and writing on love and land will inspire a rich dialogue in Australia between Aboriginal dreaming and Christian spirituality. Lord, hear us.
We remember Frank's compassionate heart that touched many of us on his journey. Full of wisdom, kindness, and intuition, he always seemed to have the right words. He knew when to speak up and when to challenge, but he also knew when to listen. Many people have talked about Frank as a visionary, but to us he was also a dreamer, and a dreaming man, and a very mystical man. He was a father for the church, but also also apply the pleading to many people. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
Frank was no stranger to insecurity, a local at the Hotel of the Edge, a patient in the Hospital of the Soul. He was well acquainted with the Arab country of heartache and pain, and yet this was the country he preferred. This was the desert, but it was irresistible for its oasis, the place from which healing emanated into the surrounding barrenness. The oasis was the Lord, or better, his sacred heart. To be Frank's friend was to come to understand this, as he helped you discover this same land yourself. The threatening land of depression and suffering, both our own and that of others, that we would rather not have to deal with. But it was at this boundary land where Jesus was able to perform his greatest work of healing, and the Holy Spirit can only enter at the edge. It was Frank's gift to be the friend, to guide us to the edge, to reassure us that the pain was okay, to sit with us while we waited for Jesus, to celebrate our healing with us, to inspire us to put the fruits of healing into action. We pray for the grace to keep the sight of our encounter with Jesus sacred in our soul. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
We were all at Central Station to farewell him, and all of us were crying. As the train pulled out, my mother ran the entire length of the platform, waving her hanky and calling out loudly, "Don't forget, you can come back tomorrow." But he didn't, and for the first time in his life, he did not obey. We thought that we would be cut off from Frank, but Frank never left us. His family were always a very important part of his life. Frank had an extraordinary inner peace, which radiated to all around him. His peace he brought to marginalized people, supporting groups such as Matt Talbot for the homeless and the St. Francis community for wounded people who had mental illness. And, of course, the Gurries. He loved them all, and he told me that this was one of being with these people was so enriching for him. For me, he was a wonderful confidant, helping me to believe in myself, to accept things that I couldn't change, and to trust God. And life would be hard without him now. We pray that his legacy lives on, as he will live on in our hearts.
We remember that Frank was a youthful teacher of
students at Chevalier for nearly a decade, teaching many of our generation. Frank also taught many of today's MSC priests and many lay Catholics. As a loving uncle to our sons Brendan and Luke and our daughter Claire, we observed how positively he has influenced their lives. Not with rebukes and reprimands, but with a gentle and soft voice, humour, and storytelling, intelligent questioning, and by his fine example. May he continue to be an inspiration to teachers, lecturers, and thinkers everywhere. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us remember Father Frank's understanding, his love, his commitment to the Aboriginal people. We will remember his respect for our culture, which he always embraced in the masses and the liturgies that he celebrated with us in the church. Aboriginal people felt like they belonged, and I must say, I never felt that before. Father understood our ways. He was there for us in times of sorrow, grief, happiness. I'll miss his sense of humour. He was funny in a funny way. Father was humble, but he was strong. I felt like he was one of us, and yet I was in awe of him at the same time. He will remain a mystery to me. Dear Lord, we pray for the many people struggling, for bread tonight, a meal tomorrow, people that Father knew well. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
This is extracted from a letter written by our son Luke from England. Frank was very like his mother. Humble, softly spoken, graceful, generous, and of course fun. And Frank was in many ways the heart of love in our family. The calming presence, the energy drawing us to each other. As we grew up, we began to realise that this kind, loving figure in our lives also affected others with the power of his spirituality and the force of his wisdom. He played a role in the wider world outside that of our family. We pray that all families may be enriched with good humour, kindness and love. Lord, hear us.
On behalf of the President, Committee and past students of Chevalier College, I wish to extend to the family and the MSC community our deepest condolences on Frank's passing. Frank arrived at Chevalier in 1957. Like many of the priests and brothers at that time, possessed distinctive qualities. We didn't necessarily look for those qualities, we looked for the frailties. And as young adolescents, we did take advantage of them. Like many of the priests who joined the MSCs, they had a vision on being a missionary. And like many, like Frank, found themselves in charge of a rather large group of testosterone-charged adolescents. The task of shepherding us would be extremely daunting to these chaps. In fact, Frank confirmed this at a function in the 80s, and he advised the gathering that he, like many of the other young priests and brothers, fresh from the seminary, were more scared and intimidated by us than we were of them. That admission certainly changed our perception of the other side as we turned them. To say that he realised his dream of being a missionary, though not in some far-flung Pacific island, but here in Sydney and in Australia at large, working with the Aboriginal community, is pleasing. We thank him for his efforts in helping us better understand Catholicism. He did run a counter strain in Chevalier, with the YCS as one chaptered comment, why run a second string against the main team? But that was Frank, and he did it quite successfully. I ask you to pray that his efforts will continue in the spirit of Jules Chevalier through his brother MSCs working throughout the world. Lord, hear our prayer.
If you had need for a friend, Father Frank would listen always. I said to Father Frank one day, the Bible was a terrible, terrible thing to us on the mission when we were growing up. But it's looking okay now, Father. Father asked, why is it looking okay? Because I'm looking at it now in an Aboriginal way. That was Father's gift to us. He gave us a place at the table. I know I've lost a friend and a mate, a very good mate, but my memories will never be taken away from me. I am who I am today because of Father Frank. We were lost and he found us. He found my family. He was one of us. He'll always be a part of us forever. Lord, we pray for the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people of this country. We ask the Lord to give us strength to carry on with the wisdom and patience that Father Frank showed us. Lord, hear us. Father Frank, I want to leave with you, to travel with you on your journey, my Aboriginal sacred heart.
Thank you.
your mercy, Lord, that this sacrifice of our service offered to the soul of Frank, your priest and servant, may now bring pardon to him who devotedly offered sacrifice to you in the church through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord is with you.
And with your spirit.
Let's lift up our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he is the salvation of the world, the life of the human race, the resurrection of the dead. Through him the host of angels adore your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim. Through him and with him and in him, our God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, and my peace I give you," look not on our sin, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let's offer each other now a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am
not
worthy to be shed out of my room, but only say the word of my soul.
Just come down this centre, either side of the casket. If you're not a Catholic or if you don't wish to go to Holy Communion, you can still be part of this little ritual. Just indicate to the priest that you might like to receive a blessing. He'll make a sign of the cross on your forehead and say a little word of peace from the Lord to you. Thank you.
Lord God, your Son Jesus Christ gave us the sacrament of his body and blood to guide us on our pilgrim way to your kingdom. May Frank, who shared in the Eucharist, come to the banquet of life Christ has prepared for us. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Just before the final commendation, we would certainly like to thank you all for being here today to remember Frank and to celebrate his life. From the front of the church, the Frank's body and the hearse will move to the monastery at Kensington, but I would think that they probably want to leave the monastery by about 1 p.m. and they expect to be at Douglas Park probably by about 2:15, I would imagine, would be the time schedule at this stage. Before we go our separate ways, let us take our leave of our brother Frank. May our farewell express our affection for him, and may it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. And one day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ which conquers all things destroys even death itself. Saints of God, come to his aid. Hasten to meet him, angels of the Lord. May Christ, who called you, take you to himself, and may the angels lead you to the bosom of Abraham.
Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High.
Eternal rest granted to him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him.
Receive his soul.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Frank, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayer. Open the gates of paradise to Frank, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we meet in Christ and are with you and our brother forever. May the angels lead you into paradise, may the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. Terry would like to have the last word.
Thank you.
Let's stand now.